the music on her pad, her iPad.
Oh, okay.
Because I've been putting it in, and I don't have some of it in, but I want to send it to her, see how it works, because I want to use mine too.
So you're gonna send it how?
From my iPad to her iPad.
Through what, Dropbox?
Or Camera.
Can I do that? Well, I don't know where to send it to.
Oh.
If I put it in Dropbox, I need her sending address.
Yeah, you do.
And I figured export or Dropbox, something like that.
I don't think we've put Dropbox in yet, and right now's not a good time.
Okay, because we got Dropbox.
Hey, how can I see who's in here by looking here?
You can't, not always. Not unless they make a comment.
Now.
No, not even make comment, because we don't have chat box.
The last one that I, the last thing you were doing when I logged into it, I could see.
You could.
Uh-huh.
Well, if you go to the webpage,
you might
then you might be able to see it, but I don't.
Go to the webpage, darn it.
And her book is out on
our
Amazon.
Camera went off.
It is. Oh, did you see it?
Mm-hmm. Oh, is it?
Yeah, it's on Amazon.
Well. Since that, you saw the skeleton in a sense before.
Yeah, right.
We did a lot more editing and change some things.
They ain't offering on Kindle.
Yeah,
they're not.
It didn't show up on Kindle. It just showed up for $9.99 for.
I've watched it on Kindle for 2 weeks now.
Have you really? Well, maybe you're not in the right place.
As long as you put down spiritual and religious.
Yeah, well, I looked it up. I had Teresa and her book and everything. But it didn't offer me on Kindle, just offered on paperback for $9.95.
No, Kindle's got it too.
Wow.
You sold any?
I have to look it up.
It's only $4 on Kindle.
Is it?
Well, we just got things squared away.
True.
We had two laybacks once we got it out there because we had to. Well, it was actually the guy that did the artwork, and he has all the templates and everything, so he had to redo a couple things. And, you know, make it work, but the book is nice. Mm-hmm. It's really nice. It's like you would hope it would be, and but it's a different. Well, see, the book's about like this.
Uh-huh.
We could have gotten down to something like that and been 100 pages. It's kind of silly.
Yeah.
Is this way you can read it much easier, and some of the pictures that she wanted on the front end and toward the end of the back there. Excuse me, that you could get them better. And so anyway, I think it's going to be very helpful to some people. I truly do. It's called In a Heartbeat.
Oh.
There are others out there I've noticed that called In a Heartbeat.
Oh.
But they're not necessarily religious books or spiritually the ones. Some are.
Don Johnson saw a heartbeat.
Yeah. It's just that was a name that came up to her, of course, but we had no clue.
Yeah,
about
sure.
About anything else about it. Mm-hmm. So it's a new venture in that regard. But Amazon's real good at the way they do things. And they advertise quite well and publicize. Of course, they're publishing. And you don't have to pay for any of that part.
Good.
Until they put one together for each order.
Oh, okay.
And so they set them up. And so all these books these guys do, that's how they do it.
Oh, wow.
I can't even imagine the data they must have to do all that stuff.
No.
So, but it's in the Lord's hands, this thing, and the the story and all that went on there about it. But it's, it's amazing business, I think.
Have you tried to sell it at church?
No, because like I said, it just came out last Friday for publishing that the book. Kindle went in a week and a half, 2 weeks ahead of it.
Yeah.
So it's been on that long, but then the book itself came out just, I think it was Friday. And the guy that did all the formatting on it got his, and he called and was telling us how nice it was. And I said, well, till the boss sees it, we go nowhere.
Is it on Amazon?
Yeah.
Yeah,
it's on Amazon.
But she likes it.
Good.
And it is good. It really is. I don't think a hardback could have the color and the nice cover to it that this has. this is the glossy, and then, and it's permanent, it's there.
Oh, good, good.
Well, anyway.
As you say, you could get a book and a free pumpkin square with purchase of the book, so.
Yeah.
There you go.
You're trying to sell that pumpkin square, aren't you?
No, you're the one that brought it up.
Well, I know, but that's the you. First, I thought you were gonna say, we'll trade you a pumpkin square for.
Yeah.
Well, you know the story of the book, don't you?
It's called In a Heartbeat.
If you're not careful, you give away to everybody. You can't afford to do that.
That's true.
So.
No, you cannot.
I figure anybody really wants it would be willing to, that's not that much. Well, I suppose we should pray, shouldn't we? Father, we come this evening, Lord God, in thanksgiving to praise and glorify you. That's truly the bottom line to all things. I know in the study of Isaiah, Father, you've shown this time and time again, and that is one of the basic themes to the entire book. And we thank you for that. We just ask you to be here, and again, Holy Spirit, have your way and say in our meeting tonight, and just let us all involve ourselves in it and be taught the best way we can in the information you have given to us. Father, we thank you for it, we praise you for it, and we always want to glorify you in everything we do. And we say this in Jesus' name, amen and amen.
I just want to know how come I'm not mentioned in it.
You don't count.
Not even in the intro. We're not on that. No credit.
No honorable mention. No nothing.
I mean,
you know what? I'll tell you what you do. You buy 100 books at least. And we'll just change that. We'll put that in there for you. How's that?
I'm just getting ahead of it. I'm just trying to get you ready for what's coming.
Oh, I see. And what is
Charlie, how come we weren't mentioned?
You know, that could be.
My feelings hurt.
You could, that
my
could
one
be.
Feeling I got hurt.
I just, and this came up a number of times.
Believe it.
But, we, you know, the thing is,
we'll
you
it.
Start doing too much of that, then everybody's going to be upset.
Exactly. Yeah. Just tell them, read the book. All you got to say, read the book.
And maybe some people wouldn't want their names in there.
Exactly.
So.
Do not be bothered.
We had,
we'll buy one.
Well, we just had to be as diplomatic about that as we could be.
I got to get something off there.
And
so. Throw it in the cart.
Well, now, I noticed Pastor opened up his sermon with some jokes Sunday. I noticed that. So he can't say anything.
I didn't know you did you?
Yeah. We got
laughed.
Today to read.
We laughed. I don't know what you were doing, but we were laughing.
Oh, I don't remember it. I tell you what.
Yeah, that's when you went to the restroom.
It could have been.
We almost made it.
I went to sleep.
I don't want to be around too much longer if this keeps up back there.
We almost made it Sunday.
We might have trouble. Yeah. Did you know that the number of the number of followers you have doesn't make you better than anybody else?
No, I don't.
Now, Hitler had millions.
Yeah.
Jesus had 12.
Yeah.
Going to church doesn't make you a Christian. Now, you love this. I bet you've heard it. Going to church doesn't make you a Christian anymore, and going to a garage makes you an automobile.
Right.
Billy Sunday didn't say that.
Identify as an automobile.
A real Christian, a real one now, is a person who can give his pet parrot to the town gossip. Think about it while you. The Bible tells us to love our neighbors and also to love our enemies. Probably because they are generally the same people. And if you use the church's Wi-Fi, are you receiving God's signals? Well, heaven goes by favor. If it went by merit, you would stay out and your dog would go in. Most people would like to be delivered from temptation, but would like it to keep in touch. I'd rather live my whole life assuming there is a God, only to find out there isn't, than to live my whole life assuming that there isn't a God.
You'd be lying.
Only to find out there is. You know, if you talk to God, you're religious. God talks to you, you're psychotic.
Yeah, that's true.
Crazy.
Mahatma Gandhi, it's amazing, he says, I like your Christ, I do not like your Christians. Your Christians are so unlike your Christ.
Yeah, that's true.
The good Lord didn't create anything without a purpose, but the fly comes close.
Oh, I tell you. They stink, these little beetles, too, Japanese beetles.
You know, the worst moment for an atheist is when he's really thankful and he has nobody to thank.
I don't understand the atheist thing.
Now, on the other hand, the Bible contains much that is relevant today, like Noah taking 40 days to find a place to park. Yeah, religion's what keeps the poor from murdering the rich. Said, I was thinking about how people seem to read the Bible a whole lot more as they get older. Mm-hmm. Then he says, it dawned on me, they're cramming for their final exam. Yeah. If there were no God, there would be no atheists. And the church is prayer conditioned. They're getting worse.
I get it.
Christian is a man who feels repentance on Sunday for what he did on Saturday and is going to do on Monday. Oh, my goodness. Maybe this world is another planet's hell.
Yeah.
Maybe this is hell.
It's getting close, isn't it?
Yep.
Some things have to be believed to be seen. Think of that.
I've seen things.
No man ever believes that the Bible means what it says. He's always convinced that it says what he means. Reagan said, I've often wondered at times what the Ten Commandments would have looked like if Moses had run them through the U.S. Congress.
Yeah.
Oh, people who want to share their religious views with you almost never want you to share yours with them.
That's true.
Hey, I had Jehovah's Witnesses pull up in my driveway and did not want to hear a word.
Oh, I have a story there. But it says, young man, the secret of my success is that at an early age I discovered I was not God.
Yeah.
Christianity is the strangest religion ever set up, for it committed a murder upon Jesus in order to redeem mankind from the sin of eating an apple. Anyway, and I have a whole bunch more, but that was supposed to do all of that. But I did find some that were kind of fun to see. That could go on and on and on. Some were by like guys like Groucho Marx, and that guy was funny.
Yeah,
the things he would it's come up with. Well, it's just true, you know. And
Harpo Marx.
Yeah.
His kind.
Is that his brother or something?
Yeah.
Some of the funnier quotes, he says, I know that there are people who do not love their fellow man, and I hate people like that. He said, it ain't those parts of the Bible that I can't understand that bothers me. It's the parts that I do understand. And it goes on. So I'll save those for later. You're going, whew. Yeah, I don't blame you.
No, I mean, no.
You need to be up there on the drums later, saying those so you can do your...
Ba-doom-bong. Yeah, yeah.
There you go.
Take my wife, please.
Yeah, take my wife.
Please.
Well, all right. We are starting on verse 5 here of chapter 43. And 5 through 7, as God will gather his peoples. In verse 5, and we have read all of this before, and I know you all been reading it all week long and studying it, so there's no need to always laughing or looking up when I say that.
I was rereading it.
Yeah, I see all the notes you made, right?
Yeah.
My phone tells me everything I need to know.
It ain't in there, you don't need to know it.
The verse 5 repeats the caution. Do not fear. So the promise of divine presence, meaning God is going to intervene mm-hmm. for protection and provision. And that's, of course, his basis for comfort to those people. And then in this verse and in the next couple of them, there's a similar number of ways that he says he's going to regather his people from all over the world, he says. All over the world. Now, does that mean the world as they knew it, as Isaiah knows it? Or when he thought world, did he think the entire globe? Did he even know there was a globe? They're probably thinking in a box there. But the Lord says he's going to speak to the north and the south and the east and the west, and that the world would give up his people. What's that mean? Now, I don't know. I'm asking a question here, what you all think that might literally mean. Could that be a rapture?
Maybe
probably
people,
not.
Maybe the people that were doing wrong will turn to God.
Ah, maybe. Maybe. Well, in verse 7, we find out that with the repetition of the creation, of the theme of it, that God's purpose then for Israel was, as he says, for my glory. And the same is true in the New Testament. You know, when he read, because where Christ always did things so that the Father might be glorified. And then later in this book, you can see in Ezekiel that the regathering is not because Israel deserved it, it's because of God's reputation, his reputation. And it was at stake through them. And he's not going to let the sins of the people rob him of his name and steal his glory. And as I get through reading it, as I was studying these things, and I'm thinking of today always. Wow. Well, at the risk of making that a little simpler than maybe it is, you might say that it means that God's establishment here of a covenant people has its purpose, that he, God, might be seen throughout the world, because glory I guess you kind of defined it as enhanced reputation, you might say, for the Lord, of course, is to honor him. And everything he does is for that purpose, for his glory. It's given to him. And that attracts a lot more kingdoms to him. So we glorify the Lord, and it's meant in part to draw people to his love. That's what it is. And I'm understanding more and more and more now. That very thing. If we go on to verse 8 through 13 here, it's going to tell us about, it says, you are witnesses, and the Lord's able to deliver his people because he alone is the sovereign Lord God. And so, let's go ahead and we'll read 8 through 13, and we'll go down and start with each verse, talk about it a little bit. He says, bring out the people who are blind, even though they have eyes, and the deaf, even though they have ears. And we'll try to figure out what does that mean. All the nations have gathered together in order that the peoples may be assembled. Who among them can declare this and proclaim to us the former things? Let them present their witnesses that they may be justified. Or let them hear and say, it is true. You are my witnesses, declares the Lord, and my servant whom I have chosen, in order that you may know and believe me and understand that I am he. Before me there was no God formed, there will be none after me. I am the Lord. There is no Savior besides me. It is I who have declared and saved and proclaimed, and there was no strange God among you. So you are my witnesses, declares the Lord, and I am God. Even from eternity, I am he. And there is none who can deliver out of my hand. I act, and who can reverse it? So the setting of this section is kind of a court scene, in a way, to determine the veracity of the claims of the Lord himself. And the witnesses are called on both sides of the case to see what the evidence will be. The use of the terms blindness and deafness, used earlier in other places, that's Israel they're referring to. And again, excuse me. So you might figure out that verse 8 there, it's kind of a call for the disobedience. It's a call for the disobedient and sinful nation to witness God's very precious provision. And these figures are hypocastasis, which is one word describing another. That's what it means. So that's where you get comparing the blindness and deafness to disobedience and spiritual ignorance. And given in the condition that Israel had the opportunity to see and hear what God was doing, so that he could qualify as witnesses to the power of God. In fact, the witness would be more effective, for they were surprised by what God had done. They weren't with him. They were surprised at what he did. And verse 9 is a challenge from God for the other nations to say anything if they or their gods were able to do it, what the Lord could do. Foretell the deliverances he had done, you know, or powerful acts, and it could be attributed to deities or kings, but predicting them is quite another thing. And God is on one side, all other powers are on the other. So who then in truth is the sovereign Lord? Well, witnesses have to step forward and give their credentials, like a theme that would run through several chapters here. They have to finally admit the truth. It's the Lord. His claims are true. His claims are true. And his claims of absolute sovereignty do stand. If we look 10 through 13, we just read. 10 begins with the first cycle where he says, "You are my witnesses." And Israel's is addressed there as the chosen servant of the Lord. And so what follows then makes some sense, because believers don't always like the idea of being chosen. They don't like it. Nor do they like the idea of being servants either. But if God's God, then most have to be both servants and the chosen. And if God was chosen by us, and he is our servant, well, not much of a God, is he, if that were the case. So the verse focuses on the purpose of, you'd call it an election, I guess. If they might know and believe that he says, "I am he." When he makes a statement like that, it becomes more powerful when we start understanding what he's truly saying there. I think we understand, well, I am he who? Well, now we're learning. This construction ends that there's two simple pronouns here that do this. One's called ani who, actually, which says, "I am he." And the statement then has a lot of significance with it, a bunch. Because the "I am the one," there's no one else. Who else matters? I'm the sovereign Lord. I have no rivals. So the point is expanded there, and there's no God before or after me, he says. The law said, "You shall have no other gods before me." And the call to Moses, remember, he said, "Well, I am that I am." How do you say How do you say what you are? And when you say what you are, why do you believe it? Why would the guys believe it that you're saying it to? Got to be some proof in there somewhere. And he's been proving it all along. So it seems that the themes running through this part of the book kind of needs to be recaptured for today, with the view of God, and because the view of God these days is that he's weak. if you stop and think about it, it must be the way the world's treating him. Or when theologians, you know, they're busy themselves trying to kind of re-image God. Well, see that going on. And in the process of making God a little God, not only and not the only God, the Lord lays down the challenge then, where he says, are the rivals. Clear back in that day. And it's just as prevalent now as it was. So I think there's a strong case that to make here about these things and the others, that the I and revelations, that in the Godhead, you know, we're speaking like the second person, the pre-incarnated, the incarnate Christ, and then the glory that he had before the foundation of the world. That he certainly is a Savior. So, we see where that's all pointing. Verse 11 repeats, kind of adds to it, where again he says, I am the Lord, there's no Savior apart from me. And the Hebrew there is pretty cryptic. Really nicely so. I Yahweh, which is a covenant name. It's a covenant name. It's personal. And it's put in place of the pronoun in place of he. There's an epithet Savior there too, which is added to the same statement. But no religion in the ancient or the modern world made such claims to be exclusively and our exclusivity, you would say, in salvation. They can't do it. There's only one God and there's only one Savior, and that is Yahweh. In verse 12. It brings in the name of prophecy. The Lord alone is not a foreign God, but was able to proclaim, declare, in addition to say, which refers back up to these, the works and the acts and things he did up we just went through. So the verse, as well as verse 13, affirms then that the Lord is the only true God, always has been, always will be, and he's completely sovereign, and no one can deliver out of his hand. Period. And no one can make him change his plans. We can ask him to, but we can't make him.
That's right.
Now, he did do that sometimes, didn't he? We go to him. But he doesn't have to. Can't make him. I've tried to, haven't you? Lord, here's what you need to do. Do this, you know.
Do it now.
Oh, boy. Yeah. Well, one can only trust the Lord and certainly not rebel against him. That would be kind of foolish. Deliverance comes from him, and judgment also, of course, comes from him. He alone can save. No one can save from him except him. And such knowledge of God must lead to faith. I guess I can say from my little limited experience I have on the net end of it, and I know people come in that don't have faith, and you can tell right away. No name to be brought up, but I can tell you, there's a circumstance where I know if this one man would lay his hands on his wife and pray a certain thing, I know it's going to happen. And he's not doing it. On the other hand, there are those who do come in. Like, look at Brother Lawrence. I know he's healed. I know he is. He's getting out of that mess. It's going to happen. It's happening. It's already happened, really. I know it's hard to get it, but it's the truth. At least that's what the Word says. So, anyway, I don't know. Do any of you have things like that? Pastor probably has dozens of them, because that's his business. But even just us that are out going, what we do, surely we see this in some ways. You know.
Sure.
I think about my grandmother. She was a heavy set. Well, let's just face it, fat old jolly woman. But I mean,
yeah.
I never heard a cross word from her. I'd never even heard a negative word out of her. It was always, hey, if something happens, you know, she'd always say, oh, that's all right. She always called me Charchi, you know. But she would say, oh, Charchi, don't worry about it. It'll be all right. This is going to be fine. Oh, it's just a little scratch here and wipe it off. You know, it was always like that. Always was. So. Well, you know, she, to me, she had asked me, I don't know if I shared this with y'all before, I might have. And I'm curious if any of you had an experience like this. You have, I know. And maybe you all have. I, what I'm referring to is when she was dying, she knew it. And I'll never forget that, standing at the foot of her bed, half of her was paralyzed with the doggone stroke that she'd had, you know. And I'm like, trying to think of the year. Well, let's see. I wasn't real old. Let's put it that way. Junior high age, I guess. But I've played my trumpet for as long as I could remember. Anyway, she wanted me to play at her funeral. Here she is, not dead, talking about her funeral. And she wanted me to play Rock of Ages. You know. And I just remember looking at her and said, I can't do that. I just couldn't do it. Oh, Archie, you'll be able to do it when the time comes. You'll do it. Well, I not only didn't do it, I didn't even go to the funeral. I could not stand to see her laying out there like that. I don't remember seeing that, thank God. I said, I stood outside the window of the funeral, you know, feeling bad that I wasn't sneaking in there, but.
It never goes away.
No, how would it?
Never.
But one, and I beat myself up about that for months and months after that.
You were just a kid.
I know. And one night I woke up right in the middle of the night. I had left the light on in my bedroom and I fell asleep on the bed. I bolted up out of bed, and I'm telling you, she was standing at the end of it. I can tell you exactly what she was wearing, and she just simply looked at me and says, Charchi, it's okay. Don't you be worrying about that. And my cousin, Susie, had the same thing, only she said she came and sat in the chair by her bed, talked with her for a while. Going,
oh, really?
That's what she said. And I started to say, no, she started to tell me what she was wearing. Well, it's the same thing exactly that she was wearing when this happened to me.
My mom came in my dreams and told me stuff that hadn't even happened yet.
So there's something there, isn't there, about those things. That's an true. Angel, maybe? I don't know. Could be, I suppose. Or maybe the five. We don't know that one, do we?
I've been there.
But yeah, I was curious about others because that's not made up. Didn't make it up. And so that's why I say with Teresa's situation, mm-hmm. when she says that she saw what she saw and experienced what she experienced, mm-hmm. I believe she did. Mm-hmm. You know,
I believe it.
God used the situation to do that with her. So it's amazing. I give her a lot of credit because she kind of exposed some things in her life that, part of her life anyway, that most people probably wouldn't want to do. But in order to get the story to make some sense, it almost had to happen. There's many other things that could have been put in there, but if that is to come out another day, who knows? Well, anyway, that's why this... And I've started studying all of this, and it just keeps on talking about to glorify. The bottom line is to glorify. The bottom line isn't necessarily to be healed or anything else. It's to glorify, period. And then when we go, and we're glorified with Him forever. Well, the conclusion then of this chapter is pretty straightforward, really. It's a message from the people of God not to fear the circumstances of life because the Lord's about to redeem them anyway in fulfillment of His promises. And He's certainly able and to do this because He is the sovereign Lord of the universe, as everyone will attest. So in our age, we can transfer a theme like that pretty easy. Jesus is the sovereign Lord of creation, the great I Am, the only Savior. And He's made promises to us, and that's including the ultimate redemption, you know, from the bondage, for one thing, of the world, and transference to His Father's house. And it was a result of that, then we should not fear anything. For he has overcome the world, he said it. And Christians should be strong in faith. We should be evaluate all of that in line with those principles. And they're certainly looking forward to the great deliverance that's coming. I hope personally that sometimes we get fear in us, you know, about something. And all I remember, the first time I ever heard it said, a message many years ago was said that faith and fear are complete opposites.
Yeah.
And faith and trust are synonymous.
Mm-hmm.
Same thing. So I think if we don't trust the Lord with something, we're not in faith about it.
Mm-hmm.
Meaning we don't think he can take care of it.
If you don't have peace in your life, you're not trusting the Lord either.
Isn't that it? Well, that's true. Hey, you're right. And then in today's ways of things, the joy of the Lord is our strength, as we've Donnie said, but it's becoming more real what that means, the joy
right.
of the Lord. It doesn't mean happiness necessarily.
No,
but we can have a contentment about where we are and what's coming.
Also, I learned one thing, be content in all things.
Amen.
Yeah, it's only human to feel all emotions. Right?
Well, it is. Of course it is. But when it controls us, then there's another thing that's just in God's way again.
Yeah, we went through that this week. And last week.
Yeah. You did?
Mm-hmm. But it was all taken care of. And we found out today it was all taken care of. But I wasn't disrupted about it. Johnny was. I kept telling him, just give it to the Lord. It'll be okay.
I got bad temper.
Follow up on
no.
it next week.
No. This week. The Irish in me. Can't help it.
Well, you know.
Temper, I'm not talking like a normal bad temper. I have an extremely bad temper.
Well, and I knew it was bad because he doesn't get out of sorts. So. And he was out of sorts.
I have a bad temper too. And. But I'm pretty much able to control it anymore because of that.
I'm getting better.
I just remember years ago going across that bridge. I'll never forget that. I decided the Bible was going to be true, and they just show me it's not.
Mm-hmm.
And but I made a vow then, too.
Well, I shut my mouth, made a phone call, and this is all
right. Well, you don't. Let's put it this way. You don't want to vow anything. You know you're not going to keep.
I don't claim nothing. I have to find out for myself.
Well, there you go. Well, it's pretty simple. I've been freed to say it now, but I just vowed I would worship God. I don't care what's going on.
Yeah.
No matter what it is, period. Regardless.
First thing we did, thank God man, for that.
There you go.
David learned that long time.
You know, it's like Brother Parker and his family. Look how they've handled that their son's death. What a witness! And I can tell you right now, within the last week and a half, two fellas have been on the net quite a while, lost their wives, both of them. They both have come back in. One says, "I can't talk very long," but he says, "Just let you know this." But he did it.
Yeah.
It took me darn near 2 years to get on there. I couldn't say a word when my wife died. Couldn't let it go. Just couldn't let it go.
It's not often easy to let go.
Yeah.
And I was talking to a young man. I said, "You need to get back to church." And he said, I've been angry.
Yeah, well, I did that too.
And he said, "I'm getting older." He said, "But it's taking me a while. I'm going to get there sooner or later." And I said, "Well, I hope it's sooner than later."
yeah, that's right.
Well, everybody always faults God, you know.
Well, sure. I'm glad he has the big, broad shoulders because he sure had to carry a lot of stuff like that.
The young man went through a lot in a short time of his life. But I think that he said, I've let go of that anger. When my dad passed away, I was depressed, real depressed for a while. Mm-hmm. And I finally just, I had to come out of it.
Yeah.
I knew it wasn't doing me any good for my family.
No, of course not.
And it took me a while.
I know. Oh, believe me. I told you before what I did after when Ethel died. I got in the living room, and I mean, I screamed. It's the one that roof stayed on. I was so angry. Because I knew he could stop that.
Sure. That's what people think.
Well, he could have. It's just he didn't. And I don't know why. Still don't know why. But all I are hearing say in the spirit is, just trust me, you wouldn't understand it. I tried, you know. So.
Well, that's where the brother and sister launch at. They don't understand why it happened, but they're trusting God anyway, you know, and they're just believing God for that he's going to. And he reads the scriptures every day I give him, and he says the prayer every day that I give him. He said, God really been showing him more and more things about what I've given him. And so. And we went up to see him. He said, I'm stronger. I'm eating. So,
how old was their son?
Oh, no, that's.
That's a different.
Talking about.
He was only.
Talking about Lawrence Bruce now.
Mid-50s, wasn't he?
Do you know Elizabeth Savannah?
Parker's son.
Yeah, he was only 50.
Yeah, he had. Yeah. He'd been having headaches. I think he probably had aneurysm.
Sounds like it, doesn't it?
He just, his wife went into the house to get something. When she came back out, he was laying on the ground. He was gone.
He was mowing for some big thing they have at their house.
Oh.
From the church.
Oh.
So, yeah.
Well, I get when it's time to go, it's time to go.
You're not going to stop it.
No.
You can worry about it.
But I've often wondered myself. I mean, I didn't. Ethel and I, neither one knew anything about healing or any of that to any extent. Certainly didn't have any belief about it particularly. But then because of that circumstance, we started to. And we started going to meetings and different things and teachings. And RSC. RL, what's the guy's name? Just passed away a couple of years ago, I guess.
She's brought.
No. Well, whoever this guy is, he has seen so many miracles in his life. Mm-hmm. And I got his book, and I was head of the elders in the church at that time. And so I got the book, and I had made them all read it, you know, to understand. We used to meet like once a month. Yeah, we met every week. Well, we should have, and we did start doing that. And reading and understanding, and I've often wondered if I'd have known more about healings and being able to stand on that, if Ethel be here yet. Maybe. We just didn't. She was healed the first time, though. Truly was. And then this comes back, and it's a whole different deal. And
usually comes back with vengeance.
She was worn out.
Yeah.
Just worn out. But I've never seen a... I never had known anybody that had such a will. She would not die. She got down to skin and bone, and she would not go. And I'll just never forget that, because the night she did was on August the 10th, 1990, and I had gotten a job on the riverboat playing, and my daughter's birthday's the next day, and I said, get one of your friends, and I'll pay for your meal and get the tickets to get on and take a ride, and I'll go ahead and work, and then we'll, you know. And as I, just before I had left, I went and sat down on the bed next to Ethel. And what I meant to say was, because I had seen her fighting, going into a coma all day long. I could tell she was. And I was trying to tell her, I said, don't go to sleep and get rest. You don't have to fight that anymore. But it didn't come out like that.
Yeah.
I gave her permission to die. Didn't know it. 10 minutes after I left, 20 minutes after I left, she was gone.
Sometimes they're waiting on that.
Let me out.
She was. I know she was. And you know, when after all the things got done and stuff, a week or 3 or 4 weeks later, I found notes that she had made, how to pay this bill, when to pay that bill,
same thing.
How to do that. I didn't know.
Yeah, she did. She did that too.
Because she did that work.
And showed her kids how joy.
She knew something.
Yeah, she knew.
And then operate the washing machine? I'd never done that.
Oh.
Well, what? No. I never done that.
Give me a break.
I have.
Take care of her. She's your wife. Well, I'm just telling you, because I never did. Anytime I did, it was always at the, whatchamacallit. Yeah.
Oh.
But I didn't know what to, you know.
Yeah. Today's got lots of buttons on them today.
Well, I'm just showing you what kind of work she did. Because in my case of teaching, I taught for,
probably gone
I was gone a lot.
Yeah.
This, I mean, the teaching took us so much time. Those kids and stuff.
Oh, we'd never seen each other for years. Weekend. That's how it is.
Well,
we just worked off shifts, so or yeah. Some different shifts, so we didn't have to have babysitter.
I just knew everything was done. I didn't want to work on.
Yeah,
I know how it is. You get complacent.
Well, it wasn't right for Ethel to be the one to do all that. She should not have.
She didn't want to do it, Charlie.
She
wouldn't have
done
it.
Well, I know that. But what I'm saying is she still should have had to do all those bills by herself.
Yeah.
It's my job, really. But with all the time, I didn't have time much to do it. Yeah. I could have made time. And if I'd have realized my place, I would have.
Me and her go back and forth sometimes.
Yeah.
Now, but
thank God we have our helpmates, you know, other things.
I could do it if I had to do it, but I know what everything is. I did it.
Well, I've learned, of course, since all that, I tell you.
Well, and, you know, like I always say, you know, her passing, you know, helped you.
Well, it did. Mm-hmm. I used to say, Lord.
I'm not meaning it in
No, I know that. But I used to say, Lord, did she have to die in order for me to wake up and grow up a bit?
Yeah.
Did she have to go through that for that? But I realized where she is. And I know that's true by Yana.
Bad things happen to good people, and it's not
yes,
right.
It does.
Yeah.
So, rains on the just and the unjust.
Yep.
Well, I like the way that it comes out with us when the guys on the net talk about that, like these fellows and their wives died. The last thing you really want to hear is, oh, they're so much happier now. And there, I want to smack them right in the face.
Yeah.
Yeah.
You grieve when they grieve, and you have joy with them when they have joy.
Yeah.
I had one guy come up to me at a funeral.
That's dumb.
My dad's funeral and said, are you being selfish?
Oh, good. Good.
I said, yeah, I am.
He betcha. Of course.
I had my dad with me.
Wouldn't you?
Yeah.
No, of course.
Sure.
I still would like to have him. But I do realize where if they knew the Lord where they are, and the honest God fact is, if it were me and I was up there, I don't think I'd care much about coming back to this. It didn't mean I don't love them. Well, why would they?
How could you?
Well, that's it. You know, with Teresa's situation, it was either that or she was being drugged down to hell. I don't know if y'all know that. And she was. She had enough going to remember to call out to the Lord.
Yeah.
And when she did, he did it. Mm-hmm. But the whole point was, and she's told you all before, but what he said, they just asked her, had he showed his love through her to anybody? Mm-hmm. She couldn't think of a soul. Mm-hmm. Which is probably true back then. She was 21 years old. And
she wasn't very old.
No. So God gave her a chance.
Yes, he did.
A big one. Now, why is there some of us, why is my back like this? Why is her hip like that? when he puts a new bone from here, clear down to their ankle, brand new. Mm-hmm. There was no bone there.
Yeah.
Powder. Yeah. Well, he can do that. Why didn't he? Well, why did Jacob limp around?
Yeah. Because he tried to hold that ankle.
To remember him by.
Because it may not be for
you.
Well.
May not
know, also might be to keep you at bay.
That's what I just said. You know.
Did you?
Yeah, well.
Just to remember just that a little bit.
Yeah, there's a reason for it.
Every time you have that pain, you know, okay, I remember the other.
You know, Paul said the messenger of Satan given to buffet him that he may be exalted above man, keep him from being exalted.
There
above
it is, see.
It kept him humble.
See,
that's right.
Because he asked God 3 times, take it away. God said, no, my grace is sufficient to get you through this. So,
yeah.
And that's not always the answer we want to hear, but that's the answer we get sometimes.
Yeah.
Well, I know why that's there.
But I was thinking, you know, when we go through things, you know, David, for 20 years, he lived in caves on the run.
Yeah, that's right, 20 years.
At the
that's
end of nice. Those 20 years, when he comes back to Ziklag, everything's gone. His wife, his children, the city is burned, there's nothing left. And his men were ready to stone him.
Yeah.
And it says that, and this is it's really a principle, because it said David encouraged himself in the Lord.
Yeah,
and when he encouraged himself in the Lord, it caused him to be victorious over the enemy, because it would not come down to that level where he would wallow in self-pity, mm-hmm. and God, why did you anoint me to be king? What is going on here? I'm living in caves, and I'm losing everything, you know? And it says right after he regained his children and his wife back, then Saul died and he became king. Right. It was almost not a very short time there. But I think it's because David, when he came to that point in his life, he encouraged himself in God. And so it changed his whole demeanor. It changed everything about him. Because David failed God, even in the wilderness. He failed God. He did some things in the wilderness he should never have done, but he did them. And he failed God in the wilderness, but he come to that point where he lost everything. And so,
well, they all the peoples that served him went through something similar.
Oh, yeah.
Yep. He used every one of them like that.
Mm-hmm. But it's,
so just think about how he's going to use you when you get right. He's not smiling. What's wrong with this picture? Look out, look out. Oh, there it is. I knew he'd have to smile. He had to do it. Well, if we didn't love you, we wouldn't get on you like that. You know that. We just.
I have heard a word last 10 minutes.
Huh? Huh?
I mean, you actually heard what you said.
I've just been sitting here.
Was he like that in class?
I didn't know him then.
Oh, I see. We only got about 4 minutes.
Just a little bit longer than all I needed.
Well, let me give you an introduction of what we're going to go to next time here.
I heard you.
I know you did. This section coming up here is verse 14 through 21, and it's about the prophet's message that God's going to deliver his people from bondage.
Mm-hmm.
The preceding section looked at God's unchallenged ability to do things. And then this part stresses that Israel doesn't deserve it. And the section falls into three main parts to it. The declaration that God will deliver them, which is 14 through 21. And there's an explanation that they don't deserve that, which is 22 through 28. And then the exhortation of not to fear, which really is in 44. We're going to be getting into chapter 44 next time. And that starts, of course, with 1. We go 1 through 5. So first part of that, just here on 14 to 21, where God's promising to deliver the people in an exodus, a great exodus, actually, and to prosper them in the time when that's going on. So that's what we're going to do, unless you got another idea. And you know what we used to say? Said, well, anybody got something they want to ask for and request? And just remember, we have to stay and play until midnight, so.
Anyway.
Well, no, we're not going to do that
one. He might be.
Yeah, really. I'd probably be late.
So let's see, what have we got here? This is the 13th, won't it?
Today's what, 6th? Yeah.
Yeah. And I wonder what y'all thinking about, you know, the next, well, the Wednesday before Thanksgiving is the night before Thanksgiving.
Right, right.
And I'm just wondering if we should do it. If families get together the night before.
I think not, because they're cooking dinner.
Well, that's what I'm saying. Yeah. They're usually doing all the stuff.
Yeah. I think not.
I got lots of stuff to do.
So maybe we'll just, yeah, let's just, no, we won't probably meet then. And y'all can breathe a sigh of relief.
No. I could run up and down steps, you know, check on food while I'm down here, up there. Down
yeah,
here.
Open the door so we can smell it.
Yeah.
Can't eat it, we just have to smell it.
No.
Turkey. That's torture, plain and simple.
Most of my stuff I don't fix till the day of, but there is a lot of prep that has to go in.
I just remember, like, Mom used to fix homemade rolls and all that jazz. So you'd smell that all night long. If you're rising before, you know.
Yeah.
I miss that. I don't get too much of that anymore.
Used to, you know, got together with your family. And I remember my aunt lived in Omaha. We lived down here. She never came down very often, but when she came down for Thanksgiving, I loved it.
Yeah.
We got to sit up and visit and talk. And
I don't think.
She was a good cook. My mother never has been. We loved it when Aunt Theola was coming over. We loved Aunt Theola coming to cook for us.
My grandmother was the one.
My mom couldn't cook a thing. She
came for a long time.
Yeah, she burned it on the outside, but it's kind of raw on the inside.
Oh,
yeah.
Oh, I wouldn't be able to do that.
Never could.
One time I remember, I think I was in college, and I'd come back like I did in the summer working, and my dad had that homemade wine, and I was so thirsty one night. and he'd put a big jug of it in the refrigerator, ice cold. And you remember those colored tin kind of glasses they used to have? God help me. I drank 7 glasses of that.
That's are we off there?
Thought it was Kool-Aid.
No, we're not off there, but I'm just making a point here.
Yeah.
When you said you couldn't stand chicken, I couldn't stand wine for 30 years.
No, that's good.
Yeah. I hate wine.
No, I could.
I don't hate it.
You have to worry about me drinking that.
No, I don't dislike it.
Well, Father God, Lord, thank you so very much for the opportunity to have fellowship here and to learn. And the word that you have given us, Father God, in the study. Thank you so much for that. We'll continue to do it, but we do understand one thing, and the bottom line truly is to glorify your name. That's what it's about. And we want to exalt you in everything that we do and say. And we praise you for it, and we do glorify you, and we give you thanks in Jesus' name. And amen. Amen to it.
Are you digging? Is that John?
Somebody's bell went off in their belfry.
It's Donald
dinging,
Trump.
But I'm not digging.
Donald, what's going on now?
So what's up, Donnie?
Oh, he's getting impeached.
Yeah. Oh, yeah.
Is he now?
Tell me about